And today we will discuss water saving approaches in rice production. First of all, I would like to show you some slides, some pictures where you will realize how important water is. Definitely, water is the most important commodity for human beings, for agriculture, for industry, for domestic work, and so on. So without water, we cannot imagine life on the earth. Even if you wish to go to any other planet, first of all, you will look for the water, you will look for the oxygen. So water is very precious commodity, and we will see how this water crisis is happening, how much shortage of water we have, and how best we can improve we can save the water, because rice consumes very large quantity of water. So now I wish to show you some pictures. This is the picture on World Water Day. Recently on March 22, we have celebrated World Water Day. Why there is need to celebrate World Water Day? It is just to make people aware about the value of water in our life. How can we survive if there is shortage of water? So some pictures are reflecting you the fight of the people to get water, just liters of water, just say 20 liter, 30 liter, 50 liter water. You can see they are standing in queues, they are quarreling, lot of things are happening, and you will not see bright pictures. And this is from mostly in African countries and in Asian countries particularly. We have very high shortage of water, particularly drinking water, water for agriculture, and so on. And see, most of the rivers and waters are polluted in the world. Even ocean water, water in lakes, water in rivers, all kind of surface water resources are polluted. And not only surface water, but groundwater is also polluted. One day I have shown you some data on groundwater pollution. So pollution is another issue related to water. And see, this picture is from some Asian country, maybe from Pakistan. You can see situation. And situation is not different in Pakistan, in Nepal also, in many Asian countries. I'm showing you examples. This picture is from Indonesia, you can see, and Pakistan. And this is the situation in Brahmaputra River, I think Brahmaputra rivers. In some place, you can see in Guwahati. So how much pollution is there in this water? And picture from Bangalore. So this is picture from Guwahati. You can see this is full of pollutants. This is river, but you can see this is full of pollutants. Water may be there, but it is not worth using in agriculture or using for drinking purpose unless treatment is done. Long queue, see the interesting serpentine queue to fetch water. And Pakistani situation, Indian situations are no different. And mostly people are responsible for pollution of the rivers or pollution of the water also. Particularly due to some religious problems, we cannot stop people to keep our water clean. And here I wish to tell you one example. That one time I visited United Kingdom, and then I asked my professor, sir, where is the drinking water? So he said, what do you mean by drinking water? Our old water is drinking water, means their tap water is drinking water. So can you imagine our tap water? Means it is through the from the municipalities water reaching our homes. That is your tap water. So their tap water is drinkable. No river is polluted there. So can we do that here? We need to think on these lines also. And see how these goats are fetching water from the holes in the earth. And this is pollution of water. You see, people are collecting polythene in water. So overall, what we see today is that there is a lot of crisis, lot of fight, lot of quarrels for water. And people across the globe, not just in Asia or India, people across the globe are fighting for water. See the case of our own country. We have issues of water with all our neighbors. whether it is Pakistan, we share a lot of water with the Pakistan, and many times there are threats from other side or this side that we will stop your water supply. So some problems are there, and see the case of Nepal. In Nepal also we have some water dispute. Certain rivers are flowing from Nepal to India. Similarly, China also Brahmaputra river is coming from Tibet, and it is controlled by China. And we have a lot of dispute with China so far water is concerned. And now recently they are going to make one dam on Brahmaputra, which will affect water supply to India. So whenever they like, they stop water flowing to India, and whenever they want, they put some excess water, and that cause flood in Assam and some other states. So that is the situation. Means we are not happy with China also. Go to Bangladesh, we have water sharing issue with Bangladesh. So again, even within the country, if you see within the country, your Punjab has problem with Haryana, or Haryana has problem with Pakistan, water sharing, then Rajasthan. And see this Kaveri dispute between two states, three states, and similarly Narmada dispute. Every river which is passing through different states, people have some kind of dispute. So why these kind of disputes are happening? Because water is a rare commodity, or water is a dear commodity. It is not that it is available at your will. So it is very limited resource, very important resource, and we should use it judiciously, considering the importance, considering the value of the water. Now, I just switch over to rice, because rice consumes very large quantities of water. Whatever water is available, fresh water is available for agriculture in India, almost 60% goes to rice. So largest consumer of water is rice crop, and as you know that water is required for agriculture, water is required for industry, and water is required for domestic uses. These are the three important uses of water. So in agriculture, whatever water is there, 60% goes to rice. So rice consume very high quantities of water. So to produce 1 kg of grain, farmers have to supply 2 to 3 times more water in rice field than other cereals. So roughly, many times you must have heard the data that 3,000 to 5,000 liters of water is required to produce 1 kg rice. And if we calculate the economics, consider the price of water 10 rupees a liter, then you can consider 3,000 to 5,000 rupees are spent for 1 kg rice. Of course, this is not drinking water, but anyhow, cost is involved in this. So the water requirement for land preparation is theoretically 150 to 200 millimeter. This much of water is consumed by rice in the land preparation, means puddling operations. So it actually varies with the one place to another place. In India, for example, if we are doing puddling, we put about 10 to 15 centimeter water in the soil and then plow it or puddle it. But there are some countries where the puddling operation spans over 2 months, sometimes 2 months, 1 month. So what they do, they repeatedly pound the water in soil, and then they plow it, puddle it, and then they wait. And after some time, say 1 week or 2 weeks, they again put some water, and it is a repeated operation. So in those cases, water requirement may be very, very high. So it can be as high as 650 to 900 millimeter when its duration is long, 24 to 48 days. Sometimes people take to have the puddling in the field in some countries. So field water requirement input during crop growth period may vary from 500 to 800 millimeter to more than 3000 millimeter. So I have shown you these kind of data regarding water requirement of rice. We have discussed in length. So overall, you can see the total water requirement of rice. This is typical seasonal water outflows and input in lowland rice. So for land preparation, it is 160 to 1560 millimeter. And for evapotranspiration, the requirement is less in wet season because of humidity. It is 400 to 500 millimeter for evapotranspiration. And in dry season, it is 600 to 700 millimeter. and it also for lost by seepage and percolation. Heavy clays, you have 100 to 500 millimeter of water input. And for loamy and sandy soil, it is still more. And for total seasonal water requirement, you can see 660 to 5,280 millimeters of water. So this is huge. And I told you average is 1250 millimeter. Now you see amount of water evapotranspired to produce 1 kilogram of major cereals. So it is just the losses of water by evapotranspiration. Not other kind of losses like percolation, seepage, and so on. So for example, rice is a C3 plant, and on an average, ET requirement is 917. And for wheat also, ET requirement is 917, almost same. But for maize, it is 556 millimeter is the water requirement for ET, evapotranspiration. So you can see in case of wheat and rice, the ET requirement is almost same. But in rice, you get other kind of losses, percolation losses, seepage losses also, which are not there in the wheat. Now, what can be done for water saving in water saving? What can we do? So there can be certain irrigation techniques in themselves that can save some water. So reduce the depth of ponded water. In case of rice, if you ask me what is the water management for irrigated rice condition, then I would say under traditional method of rice cultivation, which is raising the seedling and doing the transplanting, then water should be kept in the main field at about 5 ± 2 cm. This is the recommendation for conventional method. Means 5 ± 2 cm, that is that you need to maintain water from 3 to 7 or 8 centimeter standing water in the field throughout the growing season. So that is the recommendation for conventional rice. So why to keep 8 cm layer of water? Now question comes in water management, why to keep extra water impounded or ponded in the field? Because rice will take as the ET losses are fixed. The requirement per day is fixed. If you put some extra water, that is useless. Suppose if I eat 4 chapatis only and you put 10 chapatis. So these 10 chapatis I will not eat. I will eat only 4 chapatis. So these 6 chapatis are useless because I will not consume it. So why to keep extra water ponded in the field? Let us reduce the water depth. Let us make it just 1 or 2 cm so that I can save the water. There will be definitely reduction in the evaporation losses of the water or percolation losses of the water. Because once your height of the water is high, then your percolation losses will be more because pressure of the water on the soil will be more. If your depth is less, height is less, height of the water above the surface is less, so percolation losses will also be less. So one alternative irrigation method is to reduce the depth of the ponded water, then keeping the soil just saturated. So as I told you now, just you keep the water which is required by the crop and which can be achieved just by keeping the soil saturated. Don't go for ponded water. So this is another way, another opinion of the people, that you keep the depth of the water just saturated, not even flooded or standing water. And third extreme could be, let us have alternate wetting and drying. Let us apply water and wait for some time so that this water is not visible on the ground, on the surface of the soil. And once it has drained out, once it has been used, just you can still wait for some time to get the soil dry. Up to certain level, get the soil dry and then apply water again. So this is your alternate wetting and drying case of rice. So in all these cases, we will see how the productivity will be affected. If we go for saturated condition only, if we go for alternate wetting and drying, and what will happen to the nutrients under these three conditions. So we will discuss in subsequent lecture in detail how these three different methods of irrigation will influence the water use, how much in which system you will have less water, how it will affect the productivity, and finally how it will affect the nutrient availability. These three different methods or three different situations will affect the nutrient availability and uptake also by the rice plant. So all these issues will be discussed here and there in these lectures. And other irrigation option could be your drip system or sprinkler system. So that is also irrigation technique to save water in rice production. Now friends, let us see what are overall, as a student I am asked, what strategies would you suggest to save water in rice production? So there are three important strategies that can be used to save water. Number one, genetic improvement. Number two, crop management. And number three is your physiological approaches. So let us start with genetic improvement. In genetic improvement, you have selection and breeding strategies. So friends, there has been answer by the plant breeders for many situations. If your crop is getting affected or variety is getting affected by insect, pest and disease, so these breeders will find out the varieties which can tolerate or are resistant to insect, pest and diseases. So by breeding strategies, can the plant breeder develop varieties which consume less water, or which can grow under drought conditions, or which can grow under water limited environment? So selection and breeding strategies could be of very, very help. Particularly these days now, people are growing direct seeded rice under different systems, or your aerobic rice. So do we have any variety which can do better under these conditions? So of course, there are some options, there are some results across the globe. Chinese were the first to develop varieties for aerobic rice situation. And in India also work is going on, but we can find out genotypes which are efficient user of the water. So this is possible. And then in the molecular and biotechnological approaches can also be helpful, like C4 rice. So as you have seen, that maize is the C4 plant. So it has very high water use efficiency. Similarly, if we can have C4 rice, means more grain can be produced by less water. So people are attempting to evolve C4 rice, but there is no success yet. But if they succeed, then definitely we can grow more rice, we can produce more grain of rice with less water. Similarly, NIFGene, if NIFGenes are incorporated into rice, then these NIFGene will also help in improving the water use efficiency. So these genetic improvement or genetic approaches are quite helpful in saving the water. In some cases, they have done wonderful job. However, a lot needs to be done for developing cultivars or variety that consume less water in rice. If you reduce the duration of the variety, then yield also reduces. That is the problem. Then crop management is your cultural practices or agronomic practices through which we can save the water in rice. So agronomic practices include adoption of efficient cultural practices like selection of variety. Let us have variety which require less water or which can produce more grain with less water. Land leveling is compulsory now these days. In farmers have adopted laser land leveling, which is quite popular among the farmers. So there is no doubt about it that land leveling will result in water saving. If your lands are unleveled, in one area they have low or depressions, in other area they have upland kind of situation, higher elevation, then such undulating land, you will not get, you will need more water. Because in some area there will not be any water, in some area there will be too much of water. So both cases plants will suffer. So better to go for land leveling if you want to save water. Laser land leveling can save 20 to 30% water. Then irrigation methods are useful. For example, drip system or your sprinkler system. We will discuss how these irrigation methods are useful in saving water. Mulching can save water. I think I need not to explain, you understand that mulching reduces evaporation. Therefore, mulching can be helpful, particularly in upland rice or dry rice or direct seeded rice. This mulching is useful. Addition of organic matter definitely increases water holding capacity and losses of water are reduced. Therefore, addition of organic matter is also useful. date rate, variety, nutrient, weeds, pest management, all will affect the plant productivity. The seed rate, the date, varieties, nutrients, weeds, spore, pests, etc., they finally affect the plant productivity. So if we want to increase the water use efficiency, if we want to save the water, then we must adopt good cultural practices, good insect, pest and weed management, and effective nutrient management practices. So through all these cultural practices, we can improve the water use efficiency, which means we can save the water. Now, there are certain methods of growing rice. For example, saturated soil culture. Saturated soil culture was suggested by Borel. So it means that you keep the land saturated, you do the puddling, transplant the field, and then keep the soil just saturated. So this was suggested by him. But there are some issues related to saturated soil culture, particularly weed growth is too much, and there may be some nematode problems. Then alternate wetting and drying, it is a very good approach, and it is in operation also, it is in practice also. In many parts of irrigated rice, people follow this alternate wetting and drying method, and which definitely saves water. Then ground cover rice production system, GCRPS, ground cover rice production system, it was developed in China, and it is still working in some areas of China, where they cover the ground with polythene, and they make the holes in at a regular spaces in the polythene, and there they transplant it. So this ground cover is made from the polythene sheet, and then they realize that weeds are not there, and water use efficiency increases because of less evaporation losses. So ground cover rice production system, if you want to know in detail, I will give you reference. It is Lin et al. 2003. So this is also an option to save water. The other option is system of rice intensification that we are going to discuss in detail. This is an approach which can save about 20-30% water. We will discuss in detail today. Then aerobic rice, I will discuss in next lecture. This aerobic rice was developed to save water. So it also saves water. We will see how much water can be saved by these approaches. Raised bed was another approach that people suggested, that if you have furrow bed system or bed furrow system, so plant the rice on the beds and then irrigate through the furrows. So, but this system is quite complicated and it was not adopted by the farmers. So raised bed for transplanting. However, raised bed for direct seeded rice is okay, particularly in conservation agriculture. Raised bed system. I will show you some pictures later. Then the third approach is physiological approaches. In this seed priming. Seed priming is hydro priming. Just put the seed in water, which is a usual practice. It increases germination. It saves the water because it can save your 2 days time at least for nursery or seeding. So certain osmo protectants can be used. And silicone nutrition increases water use efficiency, and it has been found to reduce the water requirement of rice partly. So these are important approaches, genetic, agronomic and physiological approaches through which we can save water in rice production. Now see, the selection of cultivar is very, very important. Selection of varieties is very, very important. Yield of aerobic. So China have developed some varieties which are suitable for direct seeded rice under irrigated condition, where they grow aerobic rice. So varieties were HD297, HD502. And lowland genotype was JD305. Means lowland genotype means its water requirement was high, and aerobic rice means its water requirement is less. It is grown without ponded water, aerobic rice. So see the performance in two places. In China, see the first column, location. There were two locations, Changal and Changpin, 1, 2, 3, 4. So another column is soil moisture regime, and then you have variety and the yield of the variety. So see the first line, Changal, and flooded throughout rice growth. Means all the three varieties were flooded throughout the rice growing season. They were full of water. Now you can see JD305 has given highest yield, which was developed for lowland condition. but these other two varieties gave lower yield than the JD305. Means aerobic variety gave lesser yield than the lowland variety in this case, and under full water condition. And number two, Changpin 1234, another place, one situation, they kept 80 to 90% saturation throughout the rice growth. Means little bit water stress was there. Under water stress, you see this lowland variety gave half yield, 4.2, just 4.2. But other varieties gave very good yields of 4.7 and 5.3 under water stress situation. And if water stress is further reduced, further given, then this lowland variety gives you only 1.2. Means under water stress condition, this lowland rice variety has given very less yield. However, under so much of reduced water supply, these aerobic variety have given very good yield of good yields of 2.5 and 3 tons, which is double than the lowland variety. The message in brief is that the lowland varieties may not do better under aerobic situation. And similarly, aerobic variety may not do better under flooded situation. So every variety, every plant, every genotype expresses best under the suitable conditions. Jahan ka phool hai wo wahin pe wo khilega. As I repeatedly say, a flower will bloom at its right place, where it get right soil, right climate, there it will do better. See the case of quinoa. Quinoa, I think most of you must have eaten it. Quinoa is a fruit, citrus fruit, which was developed in America by Frost. Frost was the scientist in 1915. It was developed by him in California, and then he released it in 1935. And it did not do well in American conditions. And it was having bitter taste or sour taste in American conditions. Then the breeder or person tried it in different climatic conditions. He sent some saplings to other countries. And it was the fit case for Pakistan, you know. In Pakistani Punjab, it flourished like anything. It grows very tall and it produces very sweet fruits. Similarly, in Indian Punjab and parts of Rajasthan, this quinoa is giving you sweet taste. So anyway, means the best climate for this particular genotype was in Pakistani Punjab or Indian Punjab. So you need, because there it must have found the right kind of atmosphere or right kind of air, right kind of climate, right kind of soil, and so on. And all these conditions may be matching to the different phenological stages of quinoa. So therefore, under those conditions, it is doing well. Similarly for varieties of plant types. Now, as I told you, that system of rice intensification is an option, is a water-saving strategy in rice production. But many times people have reported very high yields under system of rice intensification also. I'll give you some history of this system also. And then farmers' perception have been that it system of rice intensification, I will refer just SRI or SRI. So SRI system gives you higher productivity in many countries. There are reports and reduced cost of cultivation in many places. I will discuss how the cost of cultivation can be reduced in system of rice intensification. How the water requirement is reduced. So reduced water requirement in the system, and people have experienced if you grow rice by SRI method, then it is having resistance to biotic and abiotic stresses. So, and then less adverse environmental impact. So if you adopt this system, the greenhouse gases emission is less, and therefore less impact on soil or water quality. And finally, they say that improved grain quality. So overall, what is perception of the farmer about the system of rice intensification is that It has high productivity, reduced cost of cultivation, reduced water requirement, and plants are healthy, and less environmental issues, and improved grain quality. So all goodies, all good things are happening because of SRI. It is perception of the farmer. And then, but we know that SRI method can usually raise output by 50%. These are general data about SRI, that your yield may be 50% higher. And there is a reduction in the rate of the seed. Seed requirement is reduced by 80 to 90%. Last time or sometimes I told you that the seed rate varies with the variety. Fine variety 20-25, your medium grain varieties 25-30, or then your 30-35 for board seeded variety. So in that case, you can reduce it by 80%. Means just 4-5 kg seed should be enough in this case. And water requirement is reduced by 25-50%, and there is no need to use agrochemicals. So these were the opinions of the people when the SRE was evolving, when people started experimenting on SRE. So these observations relate to that time period. Any or all variety seed can be used, and cost of production is lowered by 10-25%. And therefore, increase in or almost farmers' income can be doubled. Now, brief history. The SRI was developed in Madagascar. Madagascar is very small, tiny island country in Africa by Father Henry D. Lolaine, S.J. It is the name of the person who started this SRI method, Father Henry D. Lolaine, S.J., who spent 34 years working with farmers, observing, experimenting, and having also some good luck. So he made some discovery, some research of SRI, that young seedling, the main contribution was from his side that young seedlings should be transplanted. They have very high yield potential. That was the main finding. And those seedlings should be transplanted in single seedling should be transplanted and young seedling should be transplanted. So these were the two important discoveries by him. And in 1983, actually, he synthesized the SRI practices. And in 1999, Nanjing Agriculture University in China and AARD in Indonesia did first trials outside Madagascar. So China was the first to start experimenting SRI. And then in 2003, it was introduced in India. And by 2007, almost 22 countries were valid, started trial on SRI. So almost all Asian countries have adopted this SRI. At least they started doing experiment in 2007. Now, before we go into the other details, let us see the basic practices or differences in SRI method and conventional rice culture. So there are 4 or 5 points, see them carefully. Number one is very young seedling. So in SRI method, you need just 8-12 days old seedling. These young seedling are transplanted at most 15 days old. So they should never be more than 15. Rather, I would say they should never be more than 12 days. However, in conventional rice culture, normally 3-4 weeks old seedlings are allowed or used. Now question comes, why young seedlings? So answer is that young seedlings have very less roots. So they can easily settle or easily establish in new condition under transplanted conditions. This is one. Number two is that young seedlings are very quick to learn. Like young children are learned quickly, very quickly. And young children do not hate each other. So same way these seedlings are happy and they can accommodate, adjust to the new environment very easily. Then single seedling are transplanted very shallow, 1-2 cm depth into the muddy or unflooded field after uprooting them gently. Means here in SRI, only one seedling is planted in one place, one hill. Here there may be 2-3 or 3-4 seedlings. So here answer is why single seedling? Because the single seedling will get free space, lot of free space, and there will not be competition between two seedlings. So it will get sufficient space, light, nutrients, and it will have high tilling. So therefore, to have high tilling, to realize tilling potential of the seedling, single seedling was suggested by the proponents of this SRI method. Also, you know about family planning. If a family of two has 4 children, these resources, whatever resources are available with the person, will be divided into 4. But a person, a family having just one person, one child, so in that case, there is no question of division. Whatever resources are there, they are meant for one child only. So similarly here, if you have single seedling, all the resources will be available to the single person or single seedling. But in that case, they will be shared among the number of seedlings you are transplanting. Next is sparse plant population, means wider plant population. And ideally, it should be 25x25. This is the recommendation for SR. In most of the country now, they have settled to 25x25 spacing in SRA. However, in other method, conventional method, you see it can be 20x10, it can be 20x15 or any other spacing. But it is not square planting. It is rectangular planting in conventional rice culture, or it is random planting. So these four differences, I think, should be clear to you: young seedling, single seedling, and wider spacing of 25x25. The next important aspect of SRA or principle, these are actually principles of SRA, soil aeration is maintained during the vegetative growth period, avoiding continuous saturation. So here the main thrust is on supplying oxygen to the soil, so that aerobic conditions are there in the soil. And during these aerobic days, aerobic conditions, the microorganism living in soil will multiply very fast, and there will not be any restriction on the root growth, because under flooded situation, the root growth is very shallow. That is definitely proved that under water or flooded or ponded conditions, roots are mostly confined to the soil surface. Just they want oxygen. And more oxygen is available near the surface. So roots do not go deep into the soil. But this in aerobic, in SRA system, aeration is the need. You need to aerate the soil. And however, in conventional rice culture, you need to keep your soil saturated throughout the growing period. So here, how can we maintain the soil aeration? Soil aeration is possible by some machine. We can take your cono weeder, or we can take rotary weeder. There are some weeding machines that can aerate the soil. You can use those mechanical kind of hoeing machines, and they can aerate the soil. And also you need to apply control, you need to give the controlled supply of water, so that aerobic situation also created due to less supply of water. So through manipulation of water application and through your cono weeding, we can have some soil aeration. Next point or next principle is that weeds are controlled with a rotary hoeing machine is there that aerates the soil as it eliminates the weed and weeding 3 to 4 times before canopy closes. So I will show you how this cono weeder can be used to control the weed and to aerate the soil. So it is serving two purposes. And last principle is use compost. So compost is recommended because it will enrich your soil with microbes, and these microbes will have interaction with the roots, so that root growth will be improved and plant growth will be improved. Because once your microorganisms multiply in the soil, they also release certain hormones into the soil, and those hormones are taken up by the roots of the plants, and hence plant growth is improved by microbes. These microbes are quite useful. Similarly, if your root growth, plant growth is good, it will release more root exudates into the soil. And those root exudates will supply nutrients to the microbes. So these microbes are not fool. They are very intelligent people. Let us give some hormones, something good to the plant, and then they wait. And plant also gives them something good, which is root exudates. So it is kind of, you say, one is benefiting the other. So this compost is primarily used to increase the water situation in the soil, improve the physical property, chemical, biological properties of the soil under this. So these are the philosophy. However, in conventional rice culture, it is mostly chemical fertilizer or sometimes integrated nutrient management under conventional rice culture. So friends, these are the principles of SRI, and these are also the differences between SRI method and conventional rice culture. Hope you enjoyed them. And also I must tell it, on the left side you are seeing about 6 principles. Suppose you are not using compost, you are using just fertilizer. Then can I call it SRI? Yes, I can call it SRI. I will name modified SRI. I will name it as modified SRI method if I use fertilizer. Similarly, if I could not use the cono weeding, cono weeding is advised twice. Two times there should be cono weeding. First cono weeding should be 25 days after transplanting, 20 to 25 days after transplanting. And second cono weeding should be done at 40 to 45 days after transplanting. So these two cono weeding are necessary. If I am not doing cono weeding, will I call it SRI? Yes, I will call it modified SRI. I'm using single seedling, I'm using sparse plant population, except I'm not using young seedling. I will call, if I am following five principles, I'm not following one principle, then it will be called as modified SRI. Instead of single seedling, if I use two seedlings and all the other principles I have used, I have employed, then also I will call it modified SRI. And I need to give what I did in material and method or in methodology, I must explain it. So this is how sometimes you will hear SRI method, sometimes you will hear modified SRI system, modified SRI method. Now different paradigms. Sorry, I will continue tomorrow. And if you have any quick question, you can ask question. I will continue next time.